From the Library of Congress in Washington, D.C.
Good afternoon. I am Jane McAuliffe, who is, I'm the Director of National and International Outreach here at the Library of Congress and former director of the John W. Kluge Center. So I'm subbing this afternoon for the current director, Ambassador Robert Gallucci, who is very sorry that he cannot be with us himself. This is the moment at which I ask everyone to silence your cell phones. And in fact, in 1 minute, I'm going to scurry back to my purse and make sure I've done so myself. And also to say that today's program is being filmed and it will be put up on the Kluge Center website, as well as you can always find our things on YouTube and iTunes playlists. And you can always visit our website, the Kluge Center at the Library of Congress, to see more about the outstanding lecturers whom we are privileged to present here. Before I introduce Professor Witte, let me say a word or two about the Kluge Center itself. I like to say that the Kluge Center supports, showcases, and celebrates scholarship. We support scholarship by providing residential research opportunities for senior scholars, for postdoctoral fellows, and for PhD candidates, all right through that door there. There are many offices and carrels for the more than 100 scholars that we host in any given year. We showcase scholarship by events like this, free public lectures, seminars, and conferences that allow us to offer to you the research of the scholars who are resident in the Kluge Center. And we celebrate scholarship by the awarding of the Kluge Prize, a major award for lifetime achievement in the study of humanity, which just a few weeks ago was presented to the distinguished philosophers Jürgen Habermas and Charles Taylor. And we have with us this afternoon Professor John Witte, who is a distinguished legal scholar who for the past 4 months has held the Kluge Chair for Countries and Cultures of the North. John Witte is the Robert Woodruff University Professor of Law, the Alonzo L. McDonald Family Distinguished Professor, and the Director of the Center for the Study of Law and Religion. All of this at one place, Emory University. And I'm particularly pleased to be able to introduce John Witte to you this afternoon because years and years ago, we were colleagues at Emory University. I was a very junior colleague. He was a very distinguished senior colleague, but it's been fun to see our paths intersect occasionally over the years. John is an exceptional and an exceptionally prolific author. He has to date, and he's not finished yet, published 27 books, 15 journal symposia, 220 articles, and has delivered more than 350 public lectures around the world, including several here at the Library of Congress. John Witte's writings consider questions of family law, marriage law, the intersection of law and religion, human rights, and theology. I won't read all 27 titles, but I will give you a taste of a few of them. In 2009, he published The Sins of the Fathers, The Law and Theology of Illegitimacy Reconsidered. In 2012, he came out with Religion and the American Constitutional Experiment, actually with the third edition of that volume, and also with another book, No Establishment of Religion, America's Original Contribution to Religious Liberty, and also in that year, From Sacrament to Contract, Marriage, Religion, and Law in the Western Tradition. John has a forthcoming book entitled The Western Case for Monogamy Over Polygamy, for which he did research here at the Kluge Center in 2012 while he held the Carrie and Ann McGuire Chair in Ethics and American history. John Witte is also a terrific teacher. He has been selected 10 times by the students at Emory Law School as their outstanding professor. I can't imagine what the other faculty are thinking with each of these. Good luck to them. John has a very special relationship with the Kluge Center and the Library of Congress. As I said, he has been a scholar here for two periods of research residency. He also serves on the Library of Congress's Scholars Council, which is a very distinguished group of both American and international academics. And last June, John came back to Washington to help us celebrate the 15th anniversary of the Kluge Center in the two-day event that we hosted entitled Scholar Fest. John Witte is exactly the type of scholar, present-minded in his focus, yet deeply grounded in historical and philosophical traditions, that the immediate past Librarian of Congress, James Billington, and the philanthropist John W. Kluge had in mind when they established the Kluge Center 15 years ago. Today, John's lecture is entitled From Gospel to Law, the Lutheran Reformation and its Impact on Law, Politics, and Society. He focuses on the Protestant Reformation, which began about 500 years ago, and the consequent changes over time to constitutional order, criminal law, family law, and the laws of education and social welfare that have flowed out of that Reformation and that have profoundly shaped Western law and culture. I welcome to the podium John Witte.
Well, thank you so very much, Dr. McCullough, for your very warm and generous introduction. Good afternoon to each of you. It's a great privilege to see so many friends and family and colleagues and students, past and present, and it's a joy to be back here in the Kluge Center and to have an opportunity to enjoy a scholarly paradise. Fabulous collections of books, all on arcane subjects that I like. A wonderful community of scholars and of students who gather around the weightier matters of life and learning and the law. And I want to say a special word of appreciation and admiration to Jane McAuliffe and her successor, Ambassador Gallucci, but also the staff of the center who oftentimes get overlooked but need to be recognized for the community that they have built and that they keep together. And we want to recognize especially Mary Lou and Joanne, Denise, Travis, Jason, Dan, and a colleague or two whom I've doubtless missed in my brief time here. There's been some turnover. But I appreciate so much the hospitality you've given to me and the opportunity to be in conversation with you. I know a lot of you are here just to get to the reception afterward, and I won't try to detain you too long, but I've got about 45 minutes or so to talk to you a little bit about the impact of the Lutheran Reformation on issues of law, politics, and society as we enter as a world into the 500th anniversary celebration of the Reformation. These celebrations started 3 years ago already, and they'll go on for another decade. 2017 is the actual date, but the standard deviation for an event of this momentous proportion is rather large. But it's a little awkward for a mere law professor to be addressing Martin Luther and his impact on law, because Luther was not very nice to lawyers and to jurists and to law professors. As some of you know, he issued a number of rather strong words about the noble legal profession. They sting a bit, still 500 years later. Jurists are bad Christians. Of the gospel, law professors know nothing. Every lawyer is an enemy of Christ. We theologians have no worse enemies than jurists. There is eternal strife and warfare between jurists and theologians, theology professors and law professors. A lawyer should not speak until he hears a pig fart, for only then will his words have a proper climate to be appreciated. And more scatological still, I blank. Four-letter word, begins with S, ends with T. I blank on the law of the Pope and on the law of the emperor, and especially on the law of the jurists. So I have my work cut out for me in my little talk here. 44 minutes from now, we'll see how I do in your Q&A. On December 10, 1520, Martin Luther burned the canon law books of the medieval Catholic Church. A large group of his colleagues and students gathered in Wittenberg for the book burning. Consigned to the flames were Gratian's Decretum of 1140 and four thick books of later papal laws. Also cast into the fire were a standard confessional manual and several tomes of Catholic sacramental theology. "This might as well go in too," Luther muttered as he threw into the fire the papal bull that threatened his excommunication for heresy. Luther would later write of his canonical bonfire, "I am more pleased with this than any other action in my life." If there were a single event that signaled Luther's permanent break with Rome, this was the event. 3 years before, on October 31, 1517, Luther had posted his 95 theses on the door in Wittenberg, and there he had attacked the church's crass commercialization of salvation through the sale of indulgences. There he had ridiculed the sales pitch of the faith peddlers. "The moment your coin clinks in the bottom of my chest, the soul of your loved one will fly to heavenly rest." In several publications and debates over the next couple of years, Luther had challenged with increasing stridency the biblical integrity of the church's theology of sin, salvation, and the sacraments. In the summer of 1519, he had engaged in a sensational public debate at the University of Leipzig with Catholic uber-theologian Johann Eck. In response, Pope Leo X had issued his order of excommunication. "Arise, O Lord, a wild boar has invaded your vineyard," the bull began. And Leo went on to condemn in purplish prose the piggish Martin Luther and his teachings as heretical, scandalous, offensive, seductive, and repugnant to Catholic truth. The Pope had given Luther 60 days after receipt to recant, repent, and return quietly to the Catholic fold. December 10, 1520, was the 60th day, and on that day, Luther had his legal bonfire in Wittenberg, burning his last bridge with Rome. Luther based his attack on a radical new theology of freedom, freedom of the church from the tyranny of the Pope, freedom of the laity from the hegemony of the clergy, freedom of the conscience from the strictures of canon law. Freedom of the Christian was the rallying cry of the early Lutheran Reformation. It drove theologians and jurists, clergy and laity, princes and peasants alike, to denounce the church's legal strictures and structures with unprecedented alacrity. One by one, the structures of the church were thrust into the glaring light of the Word of God and forced to show their true colors. Few church structures survived this strict scrutiny in the heady days of the 1520s. The church's canon law books were burned. Church courts were closed, monasteries were confiscated, benefices were dissolved, church properties were seized, clerical privileges were stripped, mendicant begging was banned, mandatory celibacy was suspended, taxes to Rome were outlawed, ties to the Pope were severed. The German people were now to live by the pure light of the Word of God and the simple law of the local community. Though such attacks built on two centuries of reformist agitation in the late medieval West, it was especially Luther's theological teachings that ignited this movement in Germany. Salvation comes through faith in the gospel, Luther taught, not through works of the law. All persons stand directly before God. They're not dependent upon clerics for divine mediation. All believers are priests to their peers. They're not divided into a higher clergy and lower laity. All persons are called by God to serve in vocations. Clerics are not the only ones with a Christian calling. The church is a communion of saints, not a corporation of law. The consciences of its members are to be guided by the Bible, not governed by human traditions. The church is called to serve society in love, not to rule it by law. Law is the province of the magistrate, not the prerogative of the cleric. When put in such raw and radical terms, these theological teachings were highly volatile compounds. When sparked by Luther's pugnacious rhetoric and relentless publication program, they set off a whole series of explosive reform movements in various parts of Germany, Scandinavia, and eventually well beyond. In these early years, Luther's attack sometimes broadened into an attack on human law and authority altogether. He wrote famously in 1520, "Neither pope, nor bishop, nor prince, nor any man has the right to impose a single syllable of law upon a Christian without his consent." The Bible contains all that's needed for proper Christian living, Luther said. To subtract from the law of the Bible is blasphemy. To add to the law of the Bible is tyranny. Wise rulers, side by side with Holy Scripture, are law enough, he wrote. When jurists of the day objected that such radical biblicism was itself a recipe for blasphemy and tyranny, Luther turned on them harshly, uttering a string of the expletive-laden denunciations of lawyers with which we began. The rapid deconstruction of law, politics, and society that followed upon such shrill rhetoric plunged Germany into an acute crisis in the 1520s and 1530s. Luther had drawn too sharp a contrast between freedom and order within the church. Young Lutheran churches and clerics were treating their new liberty as license for all manner of doctrinal and liturgical experimentation and laxness. Widespread confusion reigned over preaching, prayers, and pastoral duties. Church attendance, tithe payments, and charitable offerings declined abruptly among many who took too literally Luther's teachings of free grace. Many radical social experiments were engineered out of Luther's doctrines of the priesthood of all believers and justification by faith alone. It was like Woodstock, and the hippie days of the 1960s had come four centuries too early. Moreover, Luther had driven too deep a wedge between the church's canon law and the state's civil law. Many subjects traditionally governed by the church's canon law and the vast clerical bureaucracy gathered around the bishoprics and monasteries and guilds and abbesses and other places of charity and service now remained without effective legal guidance. The vast church properties that local magistrates had confiscated were disappearing rapidly into private coffers. Drunkenness, usury, and vagabondage reached new heights. Crime, delinquency, and mendicancy soared. Marriage, divorce, and inheritance law became hopelessly confused. Schools, charities, and hospitals were closing down. Widows, orphans, and the poor were dying in the streets and in the church pews. All these subjects and many more, the Catholic canon law and church institutions had governed in detail for centuries. The new Protestant law and bureaucracy, such as it existed at all, was far too primitive to address these subjects properly. In response, the Lutheran Reformation of theology and the church quickly broadened into a reformation of law and the state as well. Deconstruction of the canon law for the sake of the gospel gave way to reconstruction of the civil law on the strength of the gospel. Castigation of Catholic clerics as self-serving overlords gave way to cultivation of Protestant magistrates as fathers of the community called to govern on God's behalf. In the 1530s and thereafter, Lutheran theologians and moralists began to pay far closer attention to the legal, social, and political implications of their new theological teachings. And they joined an impressive cadre of Lutheran jurists to craft ambitious legal reforms of church, state, and society, setting them out in typical German style in hundreds of very refined tomes and many hundreds of Reformation ordinances that poured out in the last two-thirds of the 16th century in various Lutheran polities. Critics of the day, and ever since, have regarded this legal turn of the Reformation as a corruption of original messages that Luther had offered. For some, it was a bitter betrayal of the new freedom and equality that Luther had promised. For others, it was a distortion of Luther's fundamental reforms of theology and church life. For still others, it was a simple reversion to Catholic norms now dressed up in new Protestant forms. Whatever the merits of some of these criticisms, it was the combination of theological and legal reforms that rendered the Lutheran Reformation so resolute and so resilient in the West. The reality was that Luther and the theologians needed the law and the jurists, however much they scorned them initially. It was one thing to deconstruct the legal framework of medieval Catholicism with a sharp theological sword alone. It was quite another thing to reconstruct a new Lutheran legal framework and political framework and social framework with only this theological sword in hand. Luther learned this lesson the hard way in the crisis years of the 1520s and 30s, and it almost destroyed his movement. He quickly came to realize that law was not just a necessary evil, but an essential blessing in this earthly life. It was thus both natural and necessary for the Lutheran Reformation to move from theology to law. Radical theological reforms had made possible fundamental legal reforms, and fundamental legal reforms in turn would make permanent radical theological teachings. The Lutheran Reformation became, in essence, both a theological and a legal reform movement. It struck new balances between law and gospel, order and faith, structure and spirit, and it offered sundry new theories and laws of church and state, marriage and education, social welfare and charity, that all became part of the permanent legacy of the Western tradition. The starting point for this combined theological and legal movement was Luther's complex theory of the two kingdoms. And forgive me for having to drag you through this labyrinth a little bit. We'll stop a little along the way. It's a bit like taking the kids and the grandkids through the corn maze. You get there eventually. This two kingdoms theory came together in Luther's mind in the later 1520s and 1530s and became a dominant gene in the genetic code of Lutheran theology and jurisprudence thereafter. God has ordained two kingdoms or realms in which humanity is destined to live, Luther argued, the earthly kingdom and the heavenly kingdom. The earthly kingdom is the realm of creation, of natural and civil life, where a person operates primarily by reason and law. The heavenly kingdom is the realm of redemption, of spiritual and eternal life, where a person operates primarily by faith and by love. These two kingdoms embrace parallel heavenly and earthly, spiritual and temporal forms of righteousness and justice, government and order, truth and knowledge, but they remain distinct. The earthly kingdom is distorted by sin and governed by law. The heavenly kingdom is renewed by grace and guided by the gospel. A Christian is a citizen of both kingdoms at once and invariably comes under the distinctive governments of each. As a heavenly citizen, the Christian remains free in his or her own conscience, called to live fully by the light of the gospel alone. But as an earthly citizen, the Christian is bound by law and called to obey the natural orders and offices that God has ordained for this earthly life. Luther's two kingdom was a rejection of traditional hierarchical theories of being, society, and authority. For centuries, the medieval Catholic Church had taught that God's creation was hierarchical in structure, a vast chain of being emanating from God and descending through various layers and levels of reality. In this great chain of being, each creature found its place and its purpose, and each human society found its natural order and hierarchy. It was thus simply the nature of things that some persons and institutions were higher on this chain of being, some lower. It was the nature of things that some were closer and had more ready access to God, and some were further away and in need of greater mediation in their relationships with God. This chain of being theory, which some of you will recognize from Dante's Divine Comedy, say, was one basis for traditional Catholic arguments for the natural superiority of the Pope to the Emperor, of the canon law to the civil law, of the Church to the state. Luther's Two Kingdoms theory turned this traditional ontology onto its side. By distinguishing the two kingdoms, Luther highlighted the radical separation between God and humanity. For Luther, the fall into sin destroyed the original continuity and communion between the Creator and creation. There was no chain of being descending from God. There was no stairway of merit ascending to God. Persons are born in sin into the earthly kingdom and have access to the heavenly kingdom only through faith in God's grace. Luther did not deny the traditional view that the earthly kingdom retained its natural order despite the fall into sin. There remained, in effect, a chain of being, an order in creation that gave each human being an institution, its proper place and purpose in this life. But for Luther, this chain of being was horizontal, not hierarchical. Before God, all persons and all earthly institutions were by nature equal. Luther's earthly kingdom was a flat regime, a horizontal realm of being, with no person and no institution obstructed or mediated by any other in relationship to and in accountability before God. Luther's Two Kingdoms theory also turned the traditional hierarchical theory of human society onto its side. For centuries, the Catholic Church had taught that the clergy were called to a higher spiritual service in the realm of grace, the laity to a lower temporal service in the realm of nature. The clergy were accordingly exempt from many obligations and activities of this earthly life, like marriage and warfare and taxes and litigating torts and prosecutions for crime and more. Luther rejected all of this. For him, clergy and laity were both part of the earthly kingdom and were both equal before God and all others. It was just as virtuous, just as spiritually salutary to be a butcher, a baker, or a candlestick maker than to be a priest, a bishop, or a monk, said Luther. Luther's doctrine of the priesthood of all believers at once laicized the clergy and clericized the laity. He treated the traditional clerical office of preaching and teaching as just one other vocation that any other person could pursue freely and fully in this life. He treated all traditional lay offices as forms of divine calling and priestly vocation, each providing unique opportunities for service to God, neighbor, and self. Preachers and teachers of the church, he insisted, just like housewives and magistrates and judges and soldiers, must carry their share of civic duties, pay their share of civil taxes, participate in their share of earthly activities, just like everyone else. To have a collar is not cool at all. And finally, Luther's Two Kingdoms theory turned the traditional hierarchical theory of authority onto its side. Luther rejected the medieval two-swords theory that regarded the cleric and the canon law to be naturally superior to the magistrate and the civil law. In Luther's view, God has ordained three basic forms and forums of authority for governance of this earthly life: the family, the church, and the state. All three of these are natural offices ordained by God. They represent different dimensions of God's presence and authority, and they stand equal before God and before each other in discharging their natural callings. Of these three estates, said Luther, only the state has formal legal authority, the authority of the sword to pass and enforce human laws for the governance of earthly life. The church is not a lawmaking or law-enforcing authority. It has no sword. It has no business involving itself in daily legal and political life. Its cardinal callings and signs are to preach the word, administer the sacraments, care for the poor and needy, catechize the young. It must be separate and distinct from the state in its makeup, ministry, and mission. Indeed, said Luther, quoting Ephesians 2:14, there must be, quote, a wall of separation between church and state, separate in their form, separate in their function. Luther was more concerned with the function than with the form of the state. And in various writings, he endorses emperors, kings, princes, dukes, city councils, communal governance, whatever works. Every magistrate, he wrote, from the highest king to the pettiest judge, has to be regarded as God's vice-regent in the earthly kingdom, called to elaborate and enforce God's word and will, to reflect God's justice and mercy, to appropriate and apply God's natural law. Every magistrate is also God's instrument of judgment and wrath against human sin, said Luther. Princes and judges are the bows and arrows of God, he wrote, licensed to hunt down God's enemies. The hand of the Christian magistrate, judge, or soldier that wields the sword and slays in a just cause is not man's hand, but God's. And finally, every magistrate, Luther wrote, is the father of the community, the pater politicus. The magistrate is called to care for his political subjects as if they are his children, and his political subjects are to honor and obey him as if he is their parent. Like a loving father, the magistrate must keep the peace and protect his subjects in their persons, properties, and reputations. He must deter his subjects from abusing themselves through drunkenness, prostitution, gambling, and other vices. He must maintain his subjects through the community chest, the public almshouse, the public hospital. He must educate them through the public school, the public library, the public lectern. He must see to their spiritual needs by supporting the ministry of the locally established church and encouraging attendance and participation by Sunday observance laws, tithing, and other rules. And he must set an example of virtue and piety in his own home and private life for his faithful subjects to emulate. These twin metaphors of the Christian magistrate as the lofty vice-regent of God and the loving father of the community describe the basics of Lutheran political theory for the next four centuries. For Luther, the state is divine in origin but earthly in operation. It expresses God's harsh judgment against sin, but also God's tender mercy for sinners. It communicates the law of God, but also the law of the local community. The state depends upon the church for prophetic direction, but removes from the church all jurisdiction. Either metaphor standing alone could be a recipe for abusive tyranny or officious paternalism, as we'll see in a moment. But both metaphors together provided Luther and his followers with the core ingredients of a robust Christian republicanism and a budding Christian welfare state. If I had all afternoon, I would walk you through the new bodies of law that this new Christian magistrate was to discharge in place of the Pope and the medieval Catholic Church. A whole new raft of state laws on marriage formation, maintenance, and dissolution, child care, custody and control, property inheritance, and domestic economy. Luther introducing many of the features of marriage and family life in his reforms and that of his jurists that really were the marriage law of the West until the middle of the 20th century, before the sexual and divorce revolution. If we had still more time, I would walk you through how Luther and his followers create the public school movement, introducing the idea of the public school as a civic seminary open to boys and girls alike, with mandatory school attendance, with instruction in the seven basic arts, a preparation for a vocational life, and ideally for those unusually precocious, preparing them for an education in a university and for service in church, state, and society. And if we had still more time, I would walk you through how Luther lays a lot of the foundations for the modern social welfare state and puts in place under this idea of the paternalistic pater politicus, the benign father of the community, the responsibility in the hands of the magistrate to care for the needy and the poor, the indigent, the outsider, the sojourner in their community, and to put in place many of the sturdy systems, state-run systems, that provide some of the early forms of the social welfare state, in place of monastic and guild and fraternity and sorority and other systems of diaconal care historically offered by the Catholic Church. But we don't have time for that, because I've got a few things to say by way of a bit of conclusion before we can have a little Q&A, which is the fun part. Nearly half a millennium after it first broke out in the little town of Wittenberg, the Lutheran Reformation still has a shaping influence, for better and worse, on Western theology, law, and culture. It's worth recounting the familiar but fundamental changes to theology and church life born of the Reformation. The Lutheran Reformation radically resystematized dogma. It truncated the sacraments. It revamped spiritual symbolism. It vernacularized the Bible and worship service. It transformed corporate worship and congregational music. It gave new emphasis to the pulpit and the sermon. It expanded catechesis and religious instruction. It truncated clerical privileges and church properties. It dissolved ecclesiastical foundations and endowments. It outlawed pilgrimages and the cult of religious artifacts. It rejected the veneration of non-biblical saints and the cult of the dead. It outlawed the payment of indulgences and mortuaries. It discouraged religious pilgrimage. It reduced the number of holy days. It lightened spiritual rules of diet and dress. It reformed ecclesiastical discipline and church administration, and much, much more. A leaner, a cleaner, a more participatory, and a more egalitarian church emerged as a consequence of these reforms. This theological transformation is one of the Reformation's great cultural legacies to the world. Lutheran and other churches around the world still hold firmly to many of the cardinal theological teachings of the Lutheran Reformation. Justification by faith alone, sola scriptura, the priesthood of all believers, law and gospel, sinner and saint, and more. The great Lutheran catechisms, confessions, and creeds forged in the Reformation era ring with as much power for Christians today as they did for Lutherans in the 1520s and 30s and 40s when they were crafted. The majestic hymns that Luther crafted still lift the rafters of many modern Protestant worship services. The art and the woodcuts that Luther inspired still bring gasps to many modern museum patrons. The Lutheran masterpieces of Johann Sebastian Bach and his sons are preludes to the music of heaven. The timeless language of Luther's German Bible and German Mass captures the imagination of a modern German as much as the magisterial language of the King James Bible and the Book of Common Prayer captures the imagination of the modern Englishman and woman, at least if they watch BBC. A good deal of our modern Western law and politics still bears the unmistakable marks of Lutheran Reformation theology. Today, in every Western legal system, and in the international human rights instruments as well, we protect the freedom of conscience for which Luther had risked his life and his soul. And we have placed his original understandings of religious freedom and human dignity, equality, liberty, at the cornerstones of our Western constitutional orders. Today, in most Western legal systems, marriage is still viewed as both a civil and spiritual institution, as Luther taught, whose formation and maintenance and dissolution require special legal procedures administered by authorities. Parents must still consent to the marriage of their minor children. Peers must still attest to the veracity of the marital oath. Pastors or political officials must still confirm the marital union, if not consecrated. Divorce and annulment still require a special public proceeding before a tribunal with proof of support for dependent spouses and children and a right to remarry for the parties thereafter. All this was part of Luther's original Reformation. A good deal of our modern Western struggle with law, however, is also part of the legal legacy of the Lutheran Reformation. For example, the Lutheran reformers removed the church as the spiritual ruler of Germany, an expression of their founding ideals of religious freedom. But they ultimately anointed the state as the new spiritual ruler of Germany, an expression of their new doctrines of Christian republicanism. And ever since, Germany and other Protestant nations have been locked in a bitter legal struggle to eradicate state establishments of religion and to guarantee religious freedom for all peaceable believers. The Lutheran reformers removed the Pope as, in their view, a rapacious tyrant who impugned the Christian conscience, fleeced the sheep of Christendom, and reduced the laity to quivering obedience for fear of losing their eternal life. But the Lutheran reformers ultimately anointed the prince as the lofty new vice-regent of God on earth, with far too few constitutional safeguards against his tyrannical excesses, and imparting far too few intellectual resources to support civil disobedience, let alone political rebellion, revolt, or revolution. The Lutheran reformers removed clerics as mediators between God and the laity, an expression of St. Peter's teaching of the priesthood of all believers. But they ultimately interposed husbands between God and their wives, an expression of St. Paul's teachings of male headship within the home. The Lutheran reformers outlawed monasteries and cloisters on the argument that everyone should have access to the public and private goods of marriage. But these reforms ended the vocations of many single women, placing a new premium on the vocation of marriage, which was often beyond the access of many single women in the day. Luther's legal legacy, therefore, should be neither unduly romanticized nor unduly condemned. Those who champion Luther as the father of liberty, equality, and fraternity might do well to remember his ample penchant for elitism, statism, and chauvinism. Those who see the reformers only as belligerent allies of repression and abuse should recognize that they were also benevolent agents and cultivators of education and social welfare. Prone as he was to dialectical reasoning, and aware as he was of the inherent virtues and vices of human achievement, Luther would likely have reached a comparable assessment. Such circumspection becomes doubly imperative in drawing connections between 16th century Lutheranism and 20th century Nazism. It's of course tempting to follow many modern critics who draw direct and easy lines from Luther to Hitler, from Luther's horrible 1543 sermon on the Jews and their lies, to Hitler's horrible slaughter of the Jews in the ghettos and the death camps 400 years later. Such unfathomable tragedies as the Holocaust demand villains to become a bit understandable. And so giant a personality as Luther is a natural and an easy target to single out. But we need remind ourselves of elementary facts and elementary law before drawing this indictment. The elementary facts are that Luther's late life railings against the Jews were quite in contrast to his earlier unusual solicitude for the Jews, and quite in keeping with a millennium and more of vicious anti-Semitism in the Christian tradition. Luther certainly added his own ample share of vitriol to this Christian tradition of anti-Semitism, and for that he deserves ample condemnation, doubly so given his stature, and that he knew his words would inspire some of his followers. But Luther's words were not as harsh as those of many other Protestant, Catholic, and Orthodox Christians before and after him, who condemned the Jews and called for all manner of savage abuses against them. And Luther did not act on his words in a way that many Christians before him had done and after him would do in their many brutal campaigns of persecution, ghettoization, pogromization, ostracism, and just plain thuggery and slaughter of the Jews. To indict Luther for the horrors of the Holocaust is not only to strain elementary facts, but also to strain elementary law. A conviction for unjustified homicide depends upon proof of a clear causal chain between a defendant's culpable action and the victim's ultimate deaths. The defendant's action must be the cause in fact of the victim's deaths, an action without which the deaths would not have occurred. The defendant's conduct must also be the proximate cause of the victim's deaths, close enough in time and space and foreseeability, without intervening conduct by third parties that breaks the causal chain. It is unquestionable that Luther's late life railings against the Jews were a link in the chain of causation that ultimately brought on the Holocaust. But it was but one link in a causal chain of many thousands of links, and very far removed in time, space, and foreseeability from the actual horrors of the Holocaust. I do not pass this judgment lightly. My family suffered massive losses during the Nazi occupation of their native Netherlands, and my grandparents and parents and aunts and uncles carried deep scars on their bodies, minds, and souls from the savagery, theft, rapes, kidnapping, and deprivation that were visited on them in those long years of Nazi occupation. Perhaps the statutory period on genocide, unlike that of homicide, should be infinite, not limited. Perhaps long chains of causation should be used to hang in memory, not to exonerate in casuistry all those Christian hate mongers against the Jews, however distant in time and cause from the actual events of the Holocaust. Perhaps the counsel of emotion is better than the counsel of law to deal with so evil a tragedy. Perhaps so. But for all of his rhetorical braggadocio, I think Luther would have been as horrified as any of us to see what the Holocaust had wrought. In the 100-plus thick volumes of his writings that we have before us, there is precious little to indicate that he would have condoned diabolical savagery of this proportion. Luther did no great evil in his day, albeit nothing on the scale of the Holocaust. Indeed, it was in response to that evil that he crafted his greatest hymn, "A Mighty Fortress Is Our God." His words in this hymn capture many of the cardinal convictions at the core of his dialectical theology. The contrast between Satan and Christ, body and soul, works and faith, folly and truth, despair and hope, death and life, the mortality of the earthly kingdom and the eternity of the heavenly kingdom. His words in this hymn also capture Luther's abiding faith that God and his word ultimately remain in charge of both kingdoms, even if the devil and his human minions temporarily vie for power in this lower earthly kingdom. This song is perhaps his best offering to respond to some of the failings of his own Reformation and the failings of many of his followers. I'll spare you my singing, but the poetry in the song is perhaps fitting enough as a conclusion. A mighty fortress is our God, a bulwark never failing. Our helper, he admits the flood of mortal ills prevailing. For still our ancient foe doth seek to work us woe. His craft and power are great and armed with cruel hate. On earth is not his equal. Did we in our own strength confide, our striving would be losing. We're not the right man on our side, the man of God's own choosing. Just ask who that may be. Christ Jesus, it is he. Lord Sabaoth is name, from age to age the same, and he must win the battle. And though the world with devils filled should threaten to undo us, we will not fear, for God has willed his truth to triumph through us. The prince of darkness grim, we tremble not for him. His rage we can endure, for lo, his doom is sure. One little word shall fell him. That word above all earthly powers, no thanks to them, abideth. The spirit and the gift are ours through him who with us sideth. Let goods and kindred go, this mortal life also. The body they may kill, God's truth abideth still. His kingdom is forever. Thank you very much.
Some Q&A. I think they have some microphones floating about. It might help to, for the purpose of the film, to identify yourself, and I'd be happy to follow up for those of you to whom I can't give a full enough answer or can't reach
you. Is this on? Can you hear me? Is the speaker working?
Yeah.
I'm Cliff Stearns, and the question I have is, did John Calvin then extend what Martin Luther did when he went to Geneva and set up a city and a state under Luther's Reformation work?
Yeah, no question that Calvin is following very much in Luther's footsteps, in the footsteps of the Lutheran reformers more generally, jurists and theologians and moralists alike. Calvin is in correspondence with Luther from 1536 until Luther's death in 1546. He spends time, especially with Luther's protege, Philip Melanchthon, in debating issues of theology, of jurisprudence, of moral philosophy and the like. Calvin extends some of Luther's teachings, especially on questions of political theology, as we call it today. He spends more time trying to work out a positive theory of law. Luther lays all this stuff out, his jurists lay it all out, but they don't give a hearty rationale for it. Calvin spends time working through what he calls the uses of the law. Why do we have law? Well, for civil reasons of restraint of sin, theological reasons of inducing the people to do better, and pedagogical reasons of teaching them the good works that please God, even if they can't be fully achieved. Calvin spends more time trained in law as he is working out refined ordinances on all manner of questions, not just in the basics of marriage and family and schooling and education and social welfare and charity, but he really works out a comprehensive legal system of public, private, penal, and procedural law to govern Geneva, and the package that he creates for this little town of 10,000 becomes an export. A very good export item. And it starts to get put in place in little cities all around France, the Netherlands, Scotland, England, and ultimately New England, and becomes an exportable commodity as well to Eastern Europe, and a number of reformed polities begin to pop up. And finally, Calvin, I think, spent time laying the foundation for a more robust theory of rights and resistance to tyrannical authority. Luther had that. The ingredients of that in his rejection of what he called papal tyranny, but he didn't work out any kind of strong constitutional system of resistance and rights on which a people could decide that the pervasive, persistent, chronic breach of those rights by a tyrant could trigger the fundamental right of removal of that tyrant from office. Lutherans to this day really do not have that robust theory. Calvinists made it one of their mint marks from the 1550s forward when they started facing massive genocides themselves. You start seeing the first Queen Marys in Scotland and England killing Protestants. Then you see the Spanish Inquisition unleashed on the Netherlands in the 1560s and 70s that killed many hundreds, some say as many as 20,000 Calvinists. And then in 1572, the St. Bartholomew's Day massacre in France that killed up to 100,000 Calvinists in a month of genocide. In response to all that, the question becomes, well, how do we sort out the theory of resistance to that kind of tyranny? It's one thing to just issue freedoms of Christian documents like Luther did, which was fine for its time. What was needed 50 years later was a more robust rights theory, fundamental rights theory of constitutional resistance.
And out of that exercise, Calvin in part, but especially Calvinists in his wake, self-consciously building on his formulations, start putting in place many of the ingredients of what we will call modern Western constitutionalism, working out a theory of covenant, which becomes later social contract theory, working out a theory of decalogue-based rights, which become the fundamental rights of the 18th and 19th century, working out separation of powers and checks and balances systems on the doctrine of sin, which then get picked up by the Federalists in the 18th and 19th century. It's an instructive anecdote that by 1650, each and every one of the rights that would appear in the U.S. Bill of Rights 150 years later was already defined, defended, and died for by Calvinists working out that system. Please, gentlemen in the cap, please. We want to capture you on film.
Yes, my name is Ronald Wilson. I'm with the Social Security Administration. And I just wanted to ask if you thought perhaps Luther's feelings of anti-Semitism might have had some origin in the crucifixion of Christ.
So it's the source of Luther's anti-Semitism is hard to sort out, and we have in our midst Professor Timothy Jackson, my colleague from Emory, who's working on a book on this topic, and he might want to pipe up. There is no question that Christian anti-Semitism that is in place already in the early church fathers, it begins with the very first church fathers and their diatribes against the Jews of their day, rhetorical hardball of that ancient world as Christians and Jews sought to distinguish themselves from each other and then from all the other religious and cultural groups and intellectual groups out there. But over time, especially in the High Middle Ages, when we routinize our anti-Semitism into vicious forms of pogromization and ghettoization and ultimately slaughter, the arguments on which anti-Semitism rest in part turn upon the idea that the Jews killed Christ, our Messiah, turn in part upon the Jews offended God the Father, who chose them as his chosen bride, his elect nation, and they spurned his law and are now facing the consequences of that spurning. It's in part an argument that begins to emerge out of a theory of illegitimacy. You hear in John's gospel, you hear again in some of St. Paul's letters, this idea that, look, this is the illegitimate progeny, we are the legitimate progeny of God's creative, procreative act in the world, and a variety of other things. Luther, interestingly, like any learned theologian and philosopher and moralist in the early 16th century, or late 15th century when he was educated, learned all this stuff. That hatred, that ugliness, as we now understand it, was just a part of conventional understanding of Jewish-Christian understandings in the day. There's nothing distinctive about his absorption of that tradition. He did nothing particular about the crucifixion narrative and vicarious liability that has to be borne for those that supported that. What's interesting is in 1523, he writes a very, very generous sermon about the Jews. And his argument there is very much of they are our brothers. They are our fathers and mothers, our forefathers and mothers, and adverts to the letter of Paul to the Romans, chapters 9 through 11, where we get a strong statement in the New Testament, the Christian New Testament, about, look, they are the root, we are the branches. They are the favored people of God. We now are the heirs to the special covenant that God had with them. And in that 1523 sermon, Luther, in the heyday of revolution and very much in a world formative mode, trying to create public policy, says, look, let's welcome the Jews. Let's drag away all these barriers against their inclusion in our community. Let's welcome them back from Poland, where they've been for 200 years after their pogromization from much of the West. Let's include them in our communities. Let's let ourselves marry them. Let's intermarry them. And it was a kind of a generous, fairly inclusive, religious freedom basis argument for the recognition that any serious person before God needed to enjoy freedom to worship God as they thought it appropriate. And he says very clearly in his correspondence after the 1523 sermon, look, it's up to God to decide whether God has been worshipped properly or improperly. Let the wheat and tares grow together, to use another biblical metaphor, and look, God can sort that stuff out. That's not for us. Welcome them home. Four times in the 1520s and early 1530s, he blesses the idea of Jews being integrated in the community rather than ghettoized in the corner of the community. He blesses the idea of interreligious marriage, because marriage is just a social estate. It's not a sacrament. You don't have religious barriers. You can marry Jews. Jews can marry you. You can have them in your home. You can have them in your work. You can work for them. You can be part of their home, all of which had been very fiercely forbidden. And so all that generosity is there. And then in 1543, we get Luther issuing this outrageous diatribe against Jews and repeating all the canards, including the Christ killer canard, and then repeating all the ugly things that Christians should properly, as Christian duty, do to Jews. And it's just a checklist of bigotry that you could find anywhere in the 1500 years of tracts before him. And he just lays it all out there. Now, what's Luther doing? Some think, and I'm a bit of that persuasion, that in the last 3 or 4 years of his writings, he's demented. He really is crazy. He writes some really wacko stuff the last 3 years. not just in his formal writings, but his sermons are just all over the map. His table talk entries, such as we have them, and he's crazy, number one. Second kind of theory is Luther flipped. And Luther flipped in the sense that, look, he had great solicitude for the Jews. The Jews were flourishing in his community, and he got scared. It's just like the Protestants in the 19th century that say, welcome all the Catholics, welcome all the Catholics. And as soon as they start flourishing, whoa. Religious freedom was very nice, thank you. We're not doing that anymore. There's a bit of that tone. And you can make that case out in some of his correspondence in the 1544-45 period, where he does seem to be kind of lucid and he's explaining himself. A third theory is that some Luther scholars, Martin Brecht is particularly notable in this, some Luther scholars say that Luther in his last 5 years of his life went back to the church fathers. He'd been reading the medieval guys, he'd been spending a lot of time trying to sort out the tradition, and it was back to the Bible and back to the earliest church fathers. And those earliest church fathers are not nice to Jews. And that rhetorical hardball, as I called it, was stuff that he kept on reading. And we can document pretty clearly he was reading some of these ugly early tracts, Irenaeus in particular. And it may well be that at that point he was absorbing that vitriol, and maybe he was convinced, whether with reason or without reason, convinced that maybe this is the way to go. Not clear. The consequence of it is obvious from what I tried to describe. Thank you for your question. Please, my dear colleague, Professor Dudziak. Another Kluge chair here, and if it's a hard question, she's going to answer it, and I'm going to sit down.
Not so fast. It's so nice to see you.
Indeed.
So thank you for that really wonderful and interesting lecture. I don't usually think about anything earlier than 1900. So you make a compelling case about legal origins. But then at the end of the lecture, you made a legal argument in a place that I would respectfully suggest it didn't belong. Mm. So I think that nobody in the defense of Luther, I think there are many kinds of arguments to make. I think that no one would suggest that he should be indicted. And so you were essentially defending him against an indictment. Mm. And I think the question of whether Luther is in some way culpable with regard to the Holocaust is a question that can be argued about in terms of historiography, in terms of morality and theology. But if you wanted to make a legal argument, I thought that was sort of a cheap shot. That it's just too easy. It sort of lets you off when the harder sort of historiographic questions about influence and sort of That's the terrain, I think, upon which that kind of argument would need to be defended.
So, I got to stand over here. I stood over there to get you out of the sun. I got to stand over here because the guy in the back is going to yell at me again. So, point well taken. With this strong caveat, there is a huge literature in the 1950s through 1990s from all manner of different fields of study, history, philosophy, literature, politics, international governance. Everybody was in the game. And there was a whole series of books that began to emerge that were cast in the form of legal indictments of Luther. And they are cast in the form of, well, Luther bears liability, the Lutheran community bears liability, the Lutheran community must make reparations, the Lutheran successors effectively are now beneficiaries of Luther's ugliness, the Luther's beneficiaries have also looted our art collections and a number of other things. And there's a 50-year run of this kind of literature. It's a lot of it's in German, so there's no reason to know it. Pinheaded academics like I read that stuff, most other people don't. But it's a really extraordinary set of arguments, a bit like reparations after slavery questions that sometimes sound in legal terms and get put as legal briefs in public opinion writings in particular. And it's to that literature that I was responding a bit. In the abstract, you're right, it sounds like actually a kind of a cheap shot. Playing to my strengths. I teach criminal law, know just enough to teach in the first year, but that's what I was responding to. And I'd be happy to send you some of that literature if you want to read it. It's dastardly in some sense, in terms of its legal analysis, but it gets into some of these questions of causation, and I probably should have set that up a little better. So point well taken, thank you. I'll leave it to Mr. Travis.
Hi, I'm Andrew Devereaux, also a fellow here at the Kluge Center. Yeah. Thank you very much for a really thought-provoking and compelling talk. And I have a question that has to do with the relationship between Luther's model of the two kingdoms mm-hmm. and his response to the Peasants' War yeah. in 1520s Germany. Mm-hmm. And my reading of that has always been that he argued that the peasants were justifiably enserfed on this earth, or I guess you could put it in the earthly kingdom. They were free in the heavenly kingdom, but when they appealed to Luther on the grounds of, aren't we free, don't we deserve freedom, he rejected that plea and said they misinterpreted his theology there. And in your explanation of this horizontal model rather than a hierarchical model yep. for the earthly kingdom, I was just wondering if you could expand on that a little bit yeah. and tie that in to his response to the peasant's
yeah.
plea.
Excellent question, and a difficult one where he really starts beginning to say, and footnote number 45 on my two kingdoms theory goes as follows, because he does lay out this robust theory of freedom. Everybody's equal, everybody has liberty, everybody has fraternity, everybody has sorority, everybody stands before God unencumbered by anyone else, unmediated in their access to God, unrestricted in their access to God's blessings, and it's a wonderful spiritual peon. That doesn't work at all politically, because all of a sudden, or economically, or socially, because when you look in Germany, you have this remarkable system. You talk about the one percenters. Boy, they had a one percenter system. But they also had a veritable economic caste system. A very, very carefully choreographed social, economic, linguistic, cultural set of criteria by which we arranged hierarchy. And Luther's big spiritual freedom argument comes in and blows against that with, as I said, 1960s hippie style consequences, right? Because everybody said, here finally is our savior. Here finally is somebody that's making an argument about our freedom. That we're all free. There's no clergy, no laity. There is no difference in how the peasant or the prince or the housewife or the magistrate should be dealt with. They all deserve the same. And in that kind of argument, you have revolutionary power. And it's revolutionary power that's going to be intermittently echoed in subsequent democratic revolutions all the way into the 20th century. You can hear that language over and over and over and over again. And Luther originates some of it. Some of it's just echoes that you can find all the way back in the Church Fathers. Now Luther in 1524, 25, 26, 27 is trying to figure out intellectually how to keep this together with how to mesh his robust egalitarianism with his German statism, and how to deal with the political reality that he has created liberty for all, and he's created chaos in the community as a consequence. And his two kingdoms theory is an attempt to try to keep that together. And what he's saying is, yes, you all have equality before God. You all have presumptive equality ontologically in the earthly kingdom, but you got a place in life. And now his theory of the Christian vocation, which sounded really cool, about saying, well, you're just like a pope, you're just like a prince, you're just like everybody else, now is getting used in some sense to tell people, stay in your place, stay in your vocation. God called you there, God put you there, and stay there. And how dare you get pitchforks and winnowing forks and scythes to take on the great vice regent of God who stands there with God the authority to rule. How dare you use that my spiritual freedom argument as a political revolutionary manifesto. And he's backpedaling fast. He's at footnote 43, as I said, in working out his two kingdoms theory in action. But that's kind of where he's going. And so you end up with, as typical Lutherans, dialectics. The push for spirit, freedom for all, but the reality of hierarchy that is sometimes unbreakable. The push for vocational recognition and preparation and respect for all, but the reality that there's a new elite, no longer the clerical elite, but now the political and the intellectual elite in the universities. And so it becomes a very, very hard system for Luther himself to ultimately hold together. And the settling takes a century. And the question that our first colleague, who now left, I guess he didn't like my answer, put, was the question about what Calvin does with this stuff. And Calvin tries a little bit harder to say, look, you know, the solution is in part the one I get in my answer to him, but the solution also is in part what is going to become the ingredients of federalism and factionalism. Go find a place where you like. And don't try to create a territory-wide, a Saxon-wide, a German-wide, a Sweden-wide reformation, a paradigm for all that community. Keep it small. Calvinism is ultimately a city-state religion, and it allows for people to find their distinctive socioeconomic, political, and theological place in a little community that they feel comfortable with. And Calvin, and especially his followers, echoing the Peace of Augsburg of 1555 and the Edict of Nantes of 1598 and the Peace of Westphalia of 1648, really pushed the idea of emigration. You can move. You can physically move to a new place that has a better situation for you in all the dimensions of life that are important. And that is, in some sense, one of the intellectual kernels on which we then develop the idea, look, you can change your religion. You have religious mobility. And it doesn't have to be physically relocating. It can just be eventually theoretical changing. You can go to a new faith. You can go to a new church. You can reject faith altogether. And you can then put that in social and economic terms. Social mobility arguments begin to emerge. Walter Rauschenbusch in the early 20th century takes Luther's ideas and Calvin's ideas and runs with them in working out his social gospel theory of social mobility. So you can play with all this stuff. My colleague Stephen Tipton has a wonderful set of books on this, that The Good Society in particular, they did with Bob Bella, that I would recommend as getting into some of that literature if you're interested. We'll talk some more.
We have time for one more. Okay. So,
you know what? We can get two or three and I'll try to answer. I mean, I'd rather hear from them than from me.
Okay, so we'll do all these three questions and you can choose to answer them as one or
that
separately.
That way if I can hopefully answer one of them.
Yeah, so ask your question and I'll pass the mic to these two others for their questions.
Okay. My question was, my name is Janice Gregory. I'm a neighbor of the library. Mm. And my question was, could you give a little more description of what the social justice system, helping the poor and all that, was it like, you know, soup kitchens and things like that, or did it have a little more robust going on?
Okay, thank you.
Hi, Professor Jimmy Rock.
Mr. Rock, sir, one of our great alumni.
As you were talking about Luther's two kingdoms, I was thinking of a current situation, wondering how you thought Luther might apply that framework to that, and that was the Kim Davis, the county clerk in Kentucky, who was refusing to use her earthly power and for spiritual reasons. I was wondering how you thought Luther might approach that situation.
Good. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Mira Nazar. I work here at the library. I was just going to comment about the question of the Jews and his attitude toward the Jews. I thought perhaps, was it not a bit presumptuous of him to assume that the Jews would accept his invitation to intermarry, integrate with the Gentiles? What about their own beliefs and creed? And perhaps they their rejection of him is what later on drove him to denounce them or whatever, you know.
Yeah, good. So all three are good questions. The question of how the early forms of social justice get worked out in Lutheran polities, and we have 210 Lutheran polities in the Holy Roman Empire, and so it varies, but largely what gets created is a prince-based or city council-based welfare system run by bureaucrats designed to deal with people in their place, in their homes. And the idea of the social worker who goes into the home to deliver services, whether care services, food services, emergency relief, that's one core ingredient. A second is the importance of taking care of the sojourner, the stranger, the immigrant. It's not unusual that Merkel, a daughter of a Lutheran minister, would be the one that says, all you refugees are welcome here. That's a gene in early Lutheranism, and it's manifest in the early social welfare system that the German princes and city council start putting in place, taking care of the sojourner, the stranger, not as a way of keeping the streets clean, not as a way of avoiding vagabondage or possible dangers to the public good, but rather an obligation. The blessed are the sojourners who are in your midst is a maxim that you will see on a number of these so-called community chests. And then the third thing is the very, very strong insistence on the collection of taxes from the community, which are called welfare taxes. And you have, for the first time in German history, at least in prior to, I don't know, the Saxons and what they did and the Angles what they did, but certainly in German history from the Middle Ages forward, for the first time you have a non-tithe income system of tax. It's not tithes to the church now, it's tax for welfare. And you start seeing in a number of these communities taxes collected, so there is a kitty, a coffer, that can be used for purposes of aiding the various folk that show up. The Kim Davis, Luther would say, your job is to quit. Because he would say, look, you have taken a vocation, and the vocation requires you to discharge that vocation in accordance with the terms of that vocation. You are to do it as zealously as possible. You are to make a decision in the first place as to whether that's a vocation you could discharge and all the particulars it requires. You may certainly try at the back end and the front end to reform the vocation altogether that people in your situation discharge, but your job is to do your job. And if you cannot do your job is to quit, because that is what a prophet does. A prophet does not sit and bend the rules to accommodate her own, in this case, particular claim of conscience, when somebody who has the vocation of choosing that, namely the Supreme Court in this case, has made a decision already. Your job is to quit. You're quite right that the presumptuousness of Luther and his ignorance about intermarriage and his ignorance about intermingling by a community that's just faced four centuries of vicious pogromization and abuse really does betray either charitably undue enthusiasm or less charitably a naivete about how Christians and Jews in Germany and other parts of Western Europe have gotten and can get along. Because in some sense, the invitation that he makes to the community of Christians, intermarry, intermingle, interact as fully as possible, is something that the Christians found distasteful. And in point of fact, the Jews likewise didn't interact. They came back, but they hung out with each other. They lived in their own neighborhoods. And they married their own folk, just as you would expect by a new immigrant community. The last point you made as to whether that was one of the reasons he shifts, he flips, that's the open question that back to my answer to Mr. Ron over here. We're not sure. We're not sure if he just says, look, I give you guys 20 years, statute of limitations over, we're going to go back to being bigots again, thank you. Not sure. It's not. There's just no documentation to make that case for or against. But it's a good, very good hypothesis. And a nice hypothesis on which to end. I give you Mr. Jason. Thank you so much.
This has been a presentation of the Library of Congress. Visit us at loc.gov.